not give up under any circumstances. Just like get the shot, no matter how long it takes, you know. What's the longest you've waited for a shot? I don't know, about 6 months.
What picture did you wait 6 months for?
On the day that I was walking with Joel Meyerowitz, was the day that...
This is an amazing story, my God.
And on the day that I'm walking with, you know, one of the, you know, with the history of street photography, or one of the people who are the history of photography, the picture came together. And
so, this is surreal. Hi, everybody. I'm delighted to bring you another interview. And today's guest is someone that I admire for a long time, a highly respected figure in street photography, Matt Stewart. Matt Stewart is a British photographer who lives in Amsterdam. And you've been capturing streets for what, like 20 years, maybe something like that, at least?
25 or 26 years.
Your work has been exhibited internationally, featured in various publications. I consider you, and I think you are one of the most influential street photographers of all time. Some of your projects that you may or may not talk about, I don't know, but just for people who are listening, your books, All That Life Can Afford, and the project that I love, Into the Fire. I'm not quite sure it was made into a book. And the project that brought you here is the book that will be released. I mean, the pre-orders are on, is the book that you co-authored.
It's published, yeah. It got published on April the 6th. It's called Reclaim the Street.
Exactly.
And it's a compendium. It's many, many photographers from all over the world, boys, girls, from different parts of, you know, Asia, America, Europe, Australasia. So it's a very diverse selection of people.
Wonderful. How did you select those photographers? Something I have to say about some of the those books that I have. I don't have all of them, but some of the books that I have, the A-class of street photography, or Street Photography Now, where your picture is the cover of the book. I have to say, I have worked quite a bit in Africa, and I live in South America, and I tend to see that in those books, South America or Africa are not so much represented. Is that... I'm sorry for this question. How did you select those photographers? Is that the ones you know?
First of all, I was very aware of my, you know, my privilege, you know, white European male. And so this was a difficult thing for me to do. And I tried to make sure that I was careful and sensitive in selecting a good representation of people from all over the world. Some of the countries or people that I asked didn't actually necessarily return my email. So some of the selection are not, it's not a complete, it's not like a, you know, the globe. It's just people whose work I liked, but also bearing in mind to keep a diverse edit of photography. So the photography was different throughout the book, not just one type of photography, not just pictures taken in bright light, or pictures that are funny, or pictures that are, you know, graphic, or blah, blah, blah. So I needed to be open-minded with my interpretation of street photography. Mm-hmm. And so in work that not necessarily is my favorite work, but I know that it's good in that type of street photography, or in that genre of street photography. So bearing that very much in mind, making sure there's, you know, color, black and white, flash, photographs taken at night, photographs taken, you know, in the subway, blah, blah, blah. But then also, I, as you say, you know, you realize that some of the very best photographers in the world come from Brazil, but they're hardly ever represented in street photography book or in books, full stop. And also trying my very hardest to find someone in Africa who I could use in the book. And I managed to find a guy called Madoda, who lives in, you know, Johannesburg. He lives in a, you know, a small town. It's difficult for him to make photographs using a digital camera, because he takes a digital camera out of his pocket. He's more than likely to be robbed. He shoots film. He shoots every day, and he's, you know, he's addicted to street photography like the rest of us. And thankfully, I was given his name by Lindo, a friend of mine who's a Magnum photographer, and just said you should check out Madoda. Like, he's doing it every day.
And I will definitely show some of his pictures while we talk.
I reached out to people to ask for their opinions, people who I respected, people like Gus Powell, people like Jesse Marlowe in Australia, Elizabeth Bick in America. Was very helpful, sort of gave me an insight into some of the more, you know, Yale type of photographers who've been through the education system and whose work was not on my radar. So was very grateful to her. Yeah.
Can we say that street photography is mostly male dominated? I tend to have difficulties to find women, simply put. Is it just me, or is it something that then we can see?
Yeah, it's just you.
Okay.
No, I mean, this is interesting. And this is something that I discovered on my journey is at this present moment in time, I think that women street photographers are the very best street photographers working right now, vastly superior to most of the men that are out there working. What I have discovered is the men who are doing street photography have really loud voices. And they have, and they're really interested in what they're really interested in, which is usually what other, you know, buddies are doing. And so they go into street photography like this. So they're just looking for their buddies, and they keep their very loud voices. They say what they think and what they believe, and they push who they are interested in and who they want to promote. And sadly, they're not very generous with a lot of the other people. And so this is one of the things that was kind of really bugged me about street photography. A lot of very loud men who don't really look outside of their own house.
Another thing that I saw on my YouTube channel, which is, it doesn't relate to your book, but just as an example, it's something that shocked me. I tend to talk about street photography. So it's like the main search that people discover me on my channel. It's a small channel, but yet 93% of those people are men. So it's just, it's not 70-30 or 80-20, it's 93-7. And it shocked me to see that. Anyway, I don't have an answer for that. Do you think that the genre street photography is developing?
No.
No?
I'm going to ask you some difficult questions. Okay, you ready? Yeah. You prepared for this?
I'm prepared for this.
How many women have you interviewed on your channel?
Just one, as for now. I don't have, I have not and done like 20.
How many men?
You are the fourth, I think.
Okay. So let's just, so you haven't done very many at the moment, so it could have been really like embarrassing, but so you have 1-4 ratio at the moment, which is 25-75. And
I have done some profiles. I've done some profiles of like huge photographers, and it was 50-50 for a long time. And so
I know, I don't want to in any way attack you, but this is one of the things that does generally happen is street photography is a load of, you know, blokes talking to other blokes about, you know, equipment and their shots. They're not very generous, and it's a very much a little boys' club. And what we need to do is to open our eyes and also kind of definitely, you know, promote some of the fantastic work that is coming from women in street photography right now. And they are so good. In every workshop that I do, generally the best attendees are women. They are head and shoulders better than the men, who is just all the men are concerned about is the lens they're using that day. But the women are actually looking. And I think right now the most interesting work is coming from women. And the only difficulty that women have getting recognized is the men who don't invite them to their workshops or their festivals or their blogs or their YouTube channels.
I 100% agree. And this is something that, I mean, I asked the question because it's something that I saw, and I tried to make a good part on this. And well, anyway.
No. Well, I, you know what? The reason, like I say, I in no way am I trying to attack you? It was actually something.
No. I mean, it's a legitimate question. It is something that comes to my mind.
And you know, why do we have the Vivian Mayers who were never discovered or never seen and just worked in anonymity? It's because during that time there was this very strong male curatorial, you know, sort of
gatekeepers.
Were letting in a lot of men. I mean, Vivian Mayer is probably not a very good example because she did work as a recluse and was only really discovered towards the end of her life. But I do feel that looking back through the history of photography, women have been massively, swept under the rug by the establishment that was generally run by men. And the photographers are generally men. The community is generally men, and they are the gatekeepers, and they're not allowing in women and promoting women. So one of the main things with this book was trying to find as many women with great work that could be from all over the world that I could show. And, you know, what is great work? Again, very subjective. So I have to stand back and go, you know, what is great work? You know, one of the main criteria for the portfolio section of the book is that everyone had a coherent body of work that could stick together over, you know, an 8-page spread and had a strong tone of voice and a strong style. So I started the project about 3.5 years ago with Stephen McLaren, who is the writer. And then various events unfolded, including some personal issues that he had, but also obviously COVID. And so things were slightly put on the back burner. But during that time, I was collating people to put into the book and thinking of ways of structuring the book. So I think over the last 2 years, I've worked on the book every day, on and off. I've not been paid anyway near enough money, but that's okay. And just finding people to that would fit into the jigsaw puzzle. And it became really interesting, you know, trying to work out what I needed, how I needed, who I needed, what style I needed, and what I'm missing, and things like that. So it's been very helpful as well to have advice from people like Joel Myrovitz, who is a grandfather of street photography, but also a mentor and a good friend. And they've helped me along the way just to make sure that I'm as generous as possible with who is included in the book and the types of photography that are included in the book.
Thank you, Matt, for this wonderful transition that you allow me to do, because my next question was about generosity. It's something that I heard you talking with Joel Myrovitz in lecture. You two mentioned that, and I think your book is a way of generosity. And I see you sharing so many works, so many books of other photographers. I mean, it's amazing. It's just following you on Instagram is an amazing experience to discover others' works, other talents besides what you put out. I feel that generosity is very important in this process, in photography in general. Could you elaborate on this idea of generosity or transmission? Because I think your book probably is a way of transmitting.
Yeah, I mean, so I've been working in photography for 20, 25 years, and I've seen all sorts of different types of photographer and types of generosity or even meanness, you know, on the other end of the scale. And especially when I started out, I remember, you know, working for various photo agencies and seeing how some of the photographers treated each other, often with very little respect and a sort of begrudging, yeah, generosity, you know. I remember showing the pictures that is on the front of Street Photography Now to a photographer who worked at an agency. And I said, yeah, what do you think? And he's like, oh, yeah, not bad. You know, not bad. And this was generally the kind of feedback that people gave, especially in the sort of late 90s, early 2000s. There was not much kindness or generosity. And it's something that really stuck with me. And then I met people who were generous. I met the Joel Myrovitzes of this world, the Martin Parrs of this world, who have been, you know, very kind but also sort of guide a whole generation of photographers in the way to be open, to be kind, to share, not to hide your homework. You remember at school when some people used to hide their homework, whereas, like, you know, Some people would let you copy. You're like, oh, I don't care if you copy, whatever. These guys are generous and highly influential photographers. And I think from being involved in many different things, you know, from Magnum to, you know, in public to, you know, art photographers, different collectives and agencies, I've seen the people who are mean and I've seen the people who are kind. And I think it's just a far better way in life is kind and generous. And the mean ones, they generally kind of stand out and they don't end up being very happy. So, you know, I like the full kind of 360 of everyone looking after each other.
Wonderful. Thank you for that. It's something that I've noticed in your early days, even probably before street photography, that you were involved in the skateboard scene. Can I say that? Or yeah. That you were already in the streets before shooting them. It's something that I have noticed from some friends about this competitive. I have many friends who are competitive, who come from sports. And there's this thing about street photography or photography in general that you need to warm up to get good at it. Is it because it's so hard to get a good picture? Is it because we need discipline? People who do sports at a high level tend to have more capacity for discipline. Maybe it's just me again.
I think there's definitely a degree of not giving up. It is, you know, on paper so easy, but it's actually so hard. And this is, I think, one of the things that anyone who tries it at a decent level realizes is that, you know, street photography is not easy. It's really, really difficult. I think the comparison to sport is really good. I think, you know, with people who function doing sport at a high level, there's a degree of obsession.
Trent Park was a cricket. Yeah. That's one of them.
He comes from cricket. He comes from fishing. You know, I've just spent the last couple of weeks with Trent, and he's a very keen, very good fisherman. So he can stand in the sea and catch 20 fish while someone else will stand there and catch them. So yeah, no, he's driven and he has the focus. And I think this is also something that photographers, but street photographers especially, need to have, is that sort of not give up attitude, not give up under any circumstances. Just like, get the shot, you know, get the shot. Like, it doesn't matter how long it takes, you know, what's the longest you've waited for a shot? I don't know, about 6 months, you know. And but was I happy with the shot when I got the shot? Yeah, I was happy with the shot. Was it worth it? Yeah. Happy, you know, it is, and the picture will, if it's good enough, the picture lives forever. You know, you show it and people, you know, enjoy it and hopefully are inspired by it.
What
forever.
Picture did you wait 6 months for? Please.
The peacock. Peacock with the.
Oh my God. Yeah, because you saw the peacock before? Tell me about it.
I saw the peacock many months before, and every day I would walk past the peacock just to see what was happening with the peacock. On the day that I was walking with Joel Meyerowitz was the day that
this is an amazing story. My God, this is an iconic picture of yours, and you have several. But just to think that every other day for 6 months until this thing in front of it. So this is
so it's like, and on the day that I'm walking with, you know, one of the, you know, with the history of street photography, or one of the people who are the history. Photography, the picture came together, and
this is surreal, because when you do the shot, I mean, you know how good it is. I mean, instantly, no, I think you do.
Well, you know that it's not going to move, which is a relief.
Yeah, you know you're going to get it, and you know it's good. I mean, this is amazing. Yeah. Wonderful.
No, it was a fun afternoon, and it was great to see it with Joel, and he was really kind, you know, and polite. He was like, "No, it's yours, you know, take it, you know, you." So it was, it was 6 months waiting for that picture, and I would have been happy to wait another 6 months for that picture. It's no problem, and you know, I know a lot of my other friends and, you know, colleagues, people like Trent, people like Alex Webb. You know, they spend a lot of time doing this. It's not just, you know, they flick outside the door and they, you know, land upon some great frame. You know, they throw a lot of film or a lot of pixels at the process, and it takes a while to cream to rise to the top.
Well, thank you again, because those are the people I do profiles of. Those are the photographers that I admire the most. About books, I feel like that you are more and more involved in books. Are you working on personal books? Is it something that came into your career, or did you started with putting out books? Or
always loved books. I've always loved photo books, especially actually not so much reading books, but photo books I've always loved. In fact, a couple of photo books got me into photography, one by Cartier-Bresson, one by Robert Frank. Ever since seeing those and looking through them and having the engagement and having the relationship with the book, that it's very personal. You know, the book you can take anywhere. You can take it into the car. You can take it to the park bench. You can sit on the toilet with it.
Is it the best vehicle for street photography? I think it is. No?
It's the best vehicle for photography. It's the most personal connection that I have with photography is the book. I can walk into a museum and gallery and be, you know, amazed by the print on the wall, but it feels less personal and less intimate. And I think the ownership of the book and the having the book and the relationship that you maintain with the book, that you can go back to the book and that you can have that relationship in different places and spaces with different smells, with different light, with different sounds, is really interesting. And that relationship can go on and on and on, whereas the relationship with the gallery or the print on the wall is a brief affair.
You mentioned Martin Parr. I've seen somewhere that he has put out 100 books or more. How did he do it?
First of all, you need to be good. And Martin is obviously very good. And once you get into your stride and you start to become a good photographer, like he is, you start to work out your time, how you use your time. The best way is not to waste time. So I expect, you know, Martin will have 5 or 6 or 7 projects going on at the same time, and he will be dipping into them, dipping into this one, dipping into that one, until after 2 or 3 years, he will have 7 or 8 projects completed. And seven or eight Martin Parr projects will definitely be 7 or 8 books. And also he's a big fan of the book. That is his vehicle. And he's an obsessive, he's one of the most obsessed and still obsessed photographers that I know.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Matt. That is Reclaim the Street. If you're listening to this, get your copy, order it on Amazon, anywhere where you find your books. Hopefully we'll find it in French.
Hope so. I don't know if it will be in French language. Sadly, I don't know at this point whether it's in French language or not, but it's published by Thames and Hudson, and I know that they have a very broad distribution. So I'm sure it will definitely land in French bookshops.
Thank you again, Matt. I'm really, really happy that we could have this little talk.
It's my pleasure. Thank you so much.
Thank you.